Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. My name is Eric Schwartz. I'm the Dean of the Humphrey School of Public Affairs. When we conceived of this discussion, I had envisioned a small informal faculty discussion, and we sent out the invitations just several days ago. But the response to the invitation has been quite significant, so I guess there's a lot of interest in the subject. So I want to welcome you to this faculty discussion on what to expect in a Trump administration. And we may try to go, we will try to go till about 1:15. If any of you have to leave at 1, we will understand. But I think there's so much to talk about that I expect we will go until 1:15. Let me also emphasize that we will not try to cover all issues of policy today. There is an awful lot of expertise on the faculty of the Humphrey School of Public Affairs, but having more than 6 panelists didn't really seem feasible. So there will be other opportunities for us to consider the range of policy issues that have arisen in the context of the presidential transition. Let me also emphasize that, as they should be, the views expressed by each of the panelists today, myself included, will be our own and will not represent the perspectives of the Humphrey School or the University of Minnesota. We are asking each of our panelists to speak for no more than 5 minutes so that we can have the maximum amount of time for discussion, and I believe that we'll be distributing cards for people to put questions on. So let me introduce each of the panelists in order of their presentations, and then I won't have to do introductions as we go from one to the next. Our first speaker will be Professor Ryan Allen, who chairs our Urban and Regional Planning Program and is an expert on immigration, refugee, and housing policy, among other issues. And he will speak about the policies or the possible policies of a new administration on immigration and perhaps refugee policy. And if he has a minute or two, maybe he'll talk about housing. Senior Fellow Art Rolnick, formerly of the Minneapolis Federal Reserve, will speak on education issues as well as Wall Street reform. Professor Christina Ewig, the faculty director of our Center for Women, Gender, and Public Policy, will talk about policies impacting women, including reproductive rights, equal pay, paid family leave, and childcare. Professor Anu Ramaswamy, our Denny Chair for Science and Technology. We haven't had much conversation about what she's going to speak about, but I have a hunch it's going to be about climate. And finally, Professor Raghi Assad, who runs both our Global Policy Concentration and our Masters of Development Practice programs, and I will each talk about foreign policy, and I expect that Professor Assad will focus in some measure on the Middle East. After our presentations, we may have short discussion among the panelists and then take questions on cards from you all. So without further ado, let me invite Professor Ryan Allen to offer some remarks. Ryan?
Okay, thank you very much, and welcome to the Humphrey School, everybody. From the very beginning of Donald Trump's campaign, his position on immigration, I think, has been unambiguous. And while there's good reason to believe that that we're all going to engage in a lot of guessing here, because to some extent there's been limited details on some of the policy proposals that Trump mentioned during his campaign, I feel confident in saying that the direction that he will pursue in immigration is pretty clear at this point. My position on this is that Trump will use his executive authority and where possible, work with Congress to create legislation that will enact many of his policy proposals, or seek to enact many of his policy proposals. I believe also that there will be some capacity limitations and some legal constraints and also some political constraints. But I think that what he hopes to pursue, from my perspective, is clear. How he will pursue it, I think, is up for much debate. What are the actual policies he's put forth? Let me group them into three major areas within the larger topic of immigration. The first area is he signaled strongly that he wants to reduce immigration flows to the United States generally. He's talked about quote-unquote historic norms of immigration levels and wanting to go back to an era where we had more historic norms around this that is lower. He's interested in boosting wages for workers, and he believes that one of the ways to do that is to limit immigration. He also believes that we should be more selective in the immigrants that we admit to the United States and be more attentive to admitting those that will not become a charge to the state. I would suggest to you that many of these campaign issues that he's put forth will require congressional action, and there's good reason to believe that there'll be a fair amount of debate on any kind of congressional action when it comes to immigration. But there are some things he can do through his executive authority with the Department of Labor, with Homeland Security, and the like. The second area, more generally speaking within immigration, that Trump has signaled in his campaign is, of course, around attaching immigration policy to national security interests. So in this vein, he has promised to vet immigrants to ensure that they support, quote-unquote, American values. DHS has purview of this. He has said he will temporarily suspend immigration from regions that, in his estimation, export terrorism. This also is a presidential power. He has said he will suspend visas from countries where we don't have faith we can adequately screen those applying for visas. This is something that DHS has purview over. And he's also signaled that he wants to deport criminal aliens through joint operations with subnational levels of government. This, of course, will require not only his executive authority working through DHS and through his Attorney General's office, but also working with other governments. The third area is around his intentions with unauthorized immigrants. He has suggested that he will end sanctuary cities by compelling these cities to work with immigration officials to detect and detain and eventually seek to deport unauthorized immigrants. And he will do this through removing federal funding for cities that have so far signaled a refusal to cooperate with federal immigration authorities. This will require congressional action to a large extent, and Senator Pat Toomey has recently put forward a bill to do just this, right? So that's something that's alive and well in Congress. He has suggested he will rescind DACA and DAPA. These are the deferred action executive orders. And he has also said he will triple the number of ICE agents and enforce laws preventing immigrants who lack authorization to work. Many of these things are within his purview, but certainly not all of them. So let me talk about what I think will happen in just the minute I have remaining. Speaker Ryan has signaled that there is no congressional appropriation on the table to massively increase a deportation force. Currently, the appropriation allows around 400,000 deportations a year. That's how President Obama has used it. To do what Trump has signaled he wants to do, he would have to deport the same number of immigrants that Obama did in his entire presidency in the first 100 days. That's extremely unlikely to happen for a variety of reasons. One of which is that we have due process in the United States. People who are subject to deportation have the ability to go in front of an immigration judge. And currently, there's a backlog of over 500,000 cases with an average wait time for a first appearance of nearly 2 years, right? So it's clear that even with a wave of a powerful executive authority magic wand, he will not be able to do many of the things that he wants to do. It's also clear, and this is the final point I'll make before I turn it on to my colleague, Art, that municipal governments have signaled they will not be swayed by any kind of threats, and in fact have suggested quite the opposite, the doubling down on their adherence to sanctuary city status. So the kind of legal challenges that cities will bring against a federal attempts to compel this, I am interested in seeing as they materialize. Thanks. I look forward to your questions.
All right.
Sure. Thank you. And again, welcome to the Humphrey School. So I want to touch on two topics that I've been involved with for many years, both locally and nationally. The first one has to do with banking and the Wall Street reform, known now as Too Big to Fail, specifically the Dodd-Frank Act that was passed in 2010 to try to rein in Too Big to Fail. The Trump administration has, Mr. Trump has raised some serious questions about that act, and I suspect there's going to be some major changes. So I want to touch on that, and then I want to touch on education reform. It's clear that his recommended next Secretary of Education, a woman by the name of Betsy DeVos, is clearly in favor of vouchers and private charter schools and wants significant reform towards more privatizing the public school system, if you will. So I want to touch on both of those issues and kind of speculate on where I think it's going to end up. So first on Too Big to Fail, just a little background. It's been an issue that's been around for many, many years. Large banks, we've known this, there's incentives for large banks to take a whole lot of risk. Whole lot of risk because higher risk generally means higher returns. And why should they take a lot of risk? Because if they're too big to fail, it means they win. Heads they win and tails the taxpayer loses. And this has been an issue that's been around for many, many years, and the academic community has written quite a bit about this. And we sort of anticipated the Great Recession that was led by this the debacle in the financial industry. And out of that came the Dodd-Frank bill, which is an attempt to supervise and regulate our way to a better banking system. It's got something like 260-some new rules, all sorts of requirements for large banks to report regularly. It's heavily leaning in the direction of regulating these banks. I think that's the main reason Mr. Trump has been very critical of this bill, because he feels this is too much of a burden. And as you know, he's trying to deregulate our economy generally, and this is one area where he thinks regulation has gone way too far. Fortunately, there's an alternative proposal, and the relatively new president of the Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis, Neel Kashkari, has just proposed a much different approach, and I would say a much more effective approach to dealing with Too Big to Fail, and that is to significantly raise capital requirements for this bank. And in the simple way to think about capital requirements, it requires the banks to have more of their skin in the game. The more their money is on the line, the less likely they'll take the kind of risks that we saw in the past. And this would be for our largest banks that are too big to fail, and then let them figure out then how to reorganize their businesses rather than the supervisors doing this. I have some sympathy for that approach because back in 1991, when I was directly involved with this issue under something called the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation Act, they were going to try again. The supervisors were going to take care of this problem. We were skeptical. It didn't work. The banks tend to always be one step ahead of the supervisors. So I think it would be much more effective, and if Neel Kashkari is getting some national and international attention, in fact, the Cato Institute, which is going to be one institute that's going to be advising President Trump, has endorsed this idea of let's get these banks with more skin in the game, significantly more skin in the game. He's talking about capital requirements up to 20% or more, which historically, if you go back in time, that's the time, and those are the type of capital requirements that ensured our banks were much safer. So I suspect Dodd-Frank is going to be significantly amended, if not turned over, and if again we're going to deal with too big to fail and not just let the two banks politically reign, too big to fail banks politically reign, we need to go to a Neel Kashkari approach. And given some support I know from some very conservative organizations, I think there's a chance we could end up with some pretty good bank legislation. On education reform, 1 minute. The proposed candidate, Secretary DeVos, let's be clear, she is on record. She has campaigned in Michigan and across the country for a voucher system, for allowing students, especially low-income students, to go to private schools. Clearly, that is in close to what Mr. Trump has been suggesting. The one good news for us is that they're very interested in our approach to early childhood education, a much different area, but we empower our families with early learning scholarships, and I have been contacted by the transition team. We have been asked to present our approach and our results. So it's possible that we will have a supporter in Washington in this administration for high-quality early education for our most vulnerable kids. So there's a mixed bag there from my point of view. Thank you.
Christina?
Okay. I will run through four areas of gender equality policy that are usually considered classic issues in gender equality. They are equal pay, paid family leave, child care, and reproductive rights and health. Some of you may remember that in the Republican National Convention, Ivanka Trump touted her father's support for equal pay, paid family leave, and child care policy. So we might expect to see some improvements on those fronts. But as other panelists have said, it's very soon to tell exactly what the Trump administration plans to do. We know in terms of equal pay from in his campaign statements, he was dismissive of the idea that part of the reason behind the gender wage gap was actually discrimination. And we didn't see any specific policies on the campaign trail, and we don't have clues yet as to what he will do as president on the front of equal pay. We did see some movement on paid family leave and child care, however. Part of his campaign promises were to promise 6 weeks of paid family leave, and that would certainly be an improvement over the 12 weeks unpaid we currently have in the United States as the last remaining industrialized country to not offer paid family leave. Child care, we also saw some proposals on the campaign trail, principally market-oriented types of reforms to either offer tax deductions or tax incentives for saving for child care, as well as incentivizing more community and family-based child care options. This is also an area where the United States lags behind other industrialized countries. It's one of the greatest expenses that families with children face in the United States. So this could be an improvement of sorts. We don't actually know as of yet concrete. These are still campaign promises that I'm basing this on. Where we have a better sense of where the Trump administration might go is in the area of reproductive rights and reproductive health. Reproductive rights, I'm sure that you are familiar with some of his statements with regard on the campaign trail to needing to punish women who seek abortions and of appointing a Supreme Court justice in the mold of Antonin Scalia. But abortion is just one aspect of reproductive rights and reproductive health. The appointment yesterday of Congressman Tom Price, or the proposed appointment of him as Health and Human Services Secretary, both reinforces, because Congressman Price has been against abortion and has worked in Congress to defund Planned Parenthood, reinforces that aspect of the Trump campaign platform, and we are likely to then see that in action as he takes office. But we also see Price as someone who was one of the congresspeople who actively has worked to repeal the Affordable Care Act. And it's within the Affordable Care Act that we see a number of guarantees for women's broader health issues that have improved women who are in the individual insurance market. That includes a guarantee to maternity services that previously were not guaranteed for women. A guarantee to cover breast and cervical cancer screenings, critical for women's health care. Before the Affordable Care Act, women in the individual insurance market paid, even if they lived a healthier lifestyle, paid more than men did for the same insurance policy. This is the kind of thing that my own research focuses on in Latin America, the effects of market markets within health systems and what kinds of effects they have. In my research in the Latin American context, there are two enemies to women's health. One is conservative ideology, and that is certainly something that we see on the horizon in this case. And the other is markets. That's not to say that you can't have markets within your healthcare systems, but they need to be strongly regulated because reproduction is essentially seen as a healthcare risk in the sense of a cost risk, whether it is the numerous appointments that pregnant women have, or the cost of, as we standardly have in the United States, hospital-based childcare birthing services. So these are two things to look out for should we, as we see the Trump administration implement its healthcare policies, and in particular, its proposals for repealing the Affordable Care Act.
Thank you. Thank you, Christina. Anu?
Thank you, and welcome, everyone. I'm going to talk a little bit about climate and then connect it to the EPA and environment in general and infrastructure. So I want to echo this sentiment that we don't exactly know what the new Trump administration would do. We've got some mixed signals. In terms of climate policy, President-elect Trump has appointed to the EPA transition Myron Ebell, who was a very vociferous climate denier from the conservative, from the Competitive Enterprise Institute in Washington, D.C. So we have heard, you know, so we know that that piece is there, but we also had an interesting interview that Donald Trump gave to the New York Times where he said he would have an open mind. He seemed to acknowledge that humans might have a role in climate change, so we're seeing at least two different discussions. He hasn't yet appointed an administrator to the EPA, but if you look at the news, there are two potential contenders. One of them is Scott Pruitt, who's the attorney general in Oklahoma and has actually spoken a lot against water policies of the present EPA. And the other person is Kathleen White, who is actually the administrator of EPA at the state of Texas, who's talked about restraining the imperial EPA. So there's, you can see some of these sentiments coming out. So my own feeling is that the role of the EPA will be probably diminished or constrained compared to previously. In terms of climate policy, a group of our students from the Science, Technology, and Environmental Policy Program actually went to the COP, the Conference of Parties that happened recently, and we had a short panel with Professor Gabe Chan and Ellen Anderson from the law school, and they said getting out of the Paris Treaty may not be that easy for a number of reasons, but we could, through presidential and governmental policies, reduce some of the commitments we've made, especially the Clean Power Act or the Clean Power Plan Act, which is already in the courts, which would restrain coal-burning power plants to some extent. So we could expect some of scale back there. We've seen news articles that the automobile lobby is lobbying to have, you know, not to have stringent fuel economy standards. So that may be something that's at play. But nevertheless, I think the signs are that the EPA would have reduced capacity compared to previously. So what that means is that a lot of this responsibility for climate and environment would come to state and local governments. And several states have their own climate action plans. Several states, California is a leader. You know, California, as an economy, is the fifth largest in the world. And so what we can do at the state level and the city level is immense. Several cities, more than 600 U.S. cities, have signed on to climate protection and adaptation. And at the COP and in my own work, I work closely with cities, there's just a lot of momentum towards green economy, sustainability, and health at the state and local level, which would be interesting to see how that plays. The other theme I wanted to bring out is that we've heard, the one consistent and positive thing we've heard coming out is infrastructure. So the Trump, President-elect Trump, right away said that we might have a focus on infrastructure. He talked about building beautiful infrastructure like in other countries. We've seen a lot of our infrastructures aging and failing. And so this may actually be an opportunity for Democrats. There's a lot of interest, even in the Obama administration, on infrastructure. This may be a silver lining or an area where there might be consensus. And through sensible green infrastructure, not big, massive, you know, more environmentally damaging infrastructure, there could be tremendous opportunities to benefit the environment and create local jobs and improve health. But I think it's up to all of us to make that case for what type of infrastructure investments should be made. There's been some writing about these infrastructure investments. You know, he appointed a transportation secretary recently. There'll be interest in transit, high-speed rail, really thinking through infrastructure, how it connects with employment, how it connects with the environment and with public health could be an area where we could move forward on the environment and these other objectives.
Thank you, Anu. Rung.
Well, thank you all for coming. As Eric said, I will primarily focus on the implications of a Trump administration for Middle East policy and policy towards the Islamic world. And like President-elect Trump's pronouncement on a number of issues, this area is also one in which there are a lot of potential uncertainty as well as contradictions and inconsistencies among various of these pronouncements. So I'm going to divide my comments into four areas. First, what are the implications for the conflict with the Islamic State and other extremist groups? Second, what is the implication of the stance of Donald Trump's stance on Syria and the Syrian civil war? And then what does it mean in terms of the relationship to the U.S. with kind of the rising authoritarianism in the region, in particular in Turkey and Egypt and similar countries? And then finally, what are the likely implications on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict? So let's hope I can get through all of these in 5 minutes.
I have to compliment all the panelists because you've stayed pretty much within your time.
So first on the conflict with the Islamic State and other extremist groups. I mean, I think there is clear evidence that Trump will be receiving a much better situation on the ground, given what the Obama administration has managed to do in terms of taking the fight to ISIS and dramatically reducing their territorial control. And maybe by the time January 20th comes around, there may not be much left to do on the ground. However, where I feel the problem is going to be is in the other battle, the battle for hearts and minds. And the kind of rhetoric that Mr. Trump himself and some of his appointees like General Flynn where can be really exploited by these groups to make it seem like the U.S. is in a war with Islam. And that is exactly what ISIS and Al-Qaeda and others would like. They would like to convince the Muslim world that the U.S. is at war with the whole of Islam. And this really is going to dramatically energize their ability to recruit and radicalize. And so I think that the kind of, we really have to think about this as both a military fight as well as a fight for hearts and minds. And I think the fight for hearts and minds is going to be taking a much worse turn and with very significant implications for the future. On the stance on the Syrian civil war, where basically Trump's overall stance on foreign policy, his America First stance, is one in which to minimize entanglements in foreign conflicts unless they have a direct and vital and immediate implication for U.S. interests. And in the case of Syria, this essentially means focusing on ISIS as the main enemy and that needs to be defeated. And if needed, that means cooperating with the Assad regime and its foreign allies, or at least letting them do whatever needs to be done to be able to defeat ISIS, and not worrying about their human rights record and their even any kind of massacres or that they commit against their own people. Now, already you see signs of that in which in the escalation of the war there with Russia and Syria not really caring too much about civilian casualties and their attempt to take back Aleppo and taking kind of the transition into account, and they don't see high costs being paid for that. But I think more importantly, it's the implications for that on strengthening the role of Iran in the Arab world. And already we've seen 1 minute left. Okay, already we've seen the Iran's role being strengthened by the former Republican administration through what happened in Iraq, dramatic increase in Iran's influence in the Arab world, and we're likely to see that. Now, interestingly enough, if you look at the Iranian reaction to the elections, the hardliners in Iran are extremely happy at the result of the election, and partly because of the escalation in the rhetoric and their ability then to show that they're really at war with the U.S. And convince their people, whereas, of course, the reformers in Iran find that to be calamitous because they're the ones who were staking their future on the success of the Iran deal, the nuclear deal. And so this election could dramatically switch the balance of power within Iran, which I think is bad news in favor of the hardliners. Now, let me talk about the stance of the other authoritarian regimes in the region, and particularly the Erdogan and Sisi in Egypt, Erdogan in Turkey and Sisi in Egypt. Now, both of these leaders have welcomed the election of President-elect Trump for their own reasons, even though Turkey is on the wrong side of the Syrian civil war from the one that Trump is likely to favor. They are seeing this in terms of their conflict with their internal enemies, the Gulenists, who they accuse of having orchestrated a coup attempt. And also they see it in terms of the extent to which the Trump administration will essentially not take them to task for their the switch towards greater authoritarianism and away from democracy and possibly their suppression of the free press, etc. So they think that all of these authoritarian regimes really do think that they can get away with more and won't be accountable to the U.S. in terms of their human rights and democracy records. And I think the same applies to the case of Egypt, where the Egyptian regime is being increasingly accused of human rights violations and undemocratic behavior, and they see, again, their ability to do that in a Trump administration as being enhanced or being less accountable. Now, what about the Israeli-Palestinian problem? In that case, I don't see the Trump administration will be able to move this conflict much. Already Netanyahu and the Israeli right has welcomed the Trump administration as being one that's going to be less hard on Israeli action in the occupied territories and will not attempt, as in the case of the Obama administration, to take Israel to task on that. Underline the term attempt, because Obama has not been extremely successful at it. But clearly, Trump has said that he will try to appoint his son-in-law Jared Kushner, because he is an Orthodox Jew, as to be the main envoy to try and orchestrate an Israeli-Palestinian peace. Unfortunately, Jared Kushner doesn't know the region, doesn't know very much about Israel, and for him to try to be successful in an arena which had had much more experienced negotiators trying to move this along, I think is really doubtful. So I'm going to stop here.
Say what you think, Raghi. I'm going to offer some substantive comments myself. And if I'm the one making the rule about 5 minutes, I better stick to it. By many accounts, and certainly by my own estimation, the United States is confronting national security challenges as profound as any we've encountered in the past 50 years. And so what does that mean? It means, compared to decades past, the risks we face are more serious. The risks are more likely to become realities in the short term or over time, and most significantly, to threaten the well-being of the citizens of the United States. And that's why foreign policy matters. And if this challenge wasn't enough, we confront these realities at a time in which worldwide power and influence is shifting in a dramatic fashion. According to the U.S. National Intelligence Council, and I quote, the diffusion of power among countries will have a dramatic impact by 2030. Asia will have surpassed North America and Europe combined, in terms of global power. China alone will probably have the largest economy, surpassing that of the United States a few years before 2030. So what this means for our foreign policy and national security is pretty simple. That while the United States remains the world's dominant power, the United States' margin for error is diminishing rapidly and inevitably. In the coming years, sustaining U.S. interests will require the very careful marshaling of all of the tools of U.S. influence. So in this context, what can we expect from a Trump foreign policy? The short answer is that we don't really know for certain. The president-elect's comments about the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, for example, and his expressed willingness to link alliance security guarantees to a willingness on the part of allies to pay up, suggests that he is skeptical or even disdainful about the benefits to the United States of alliance relationships in which the United States has borne the major share of military responsibilities and costs. More significantly, to my mind, and I'm going to paraphrase our former Humphrey School colleague, Michael Barnett, the president-elect's vision of America in the world certainly emphasizes the importance of power, but doesn't seem to address the issue of purpose. And as Barnett correctly notes, this seems to distinguish President-elect Trump from all of his recent predecessors. To be sure, different U.S. presidents have had different conceptions of this notion of American exceptionalism. But to quote Michael Barnett, one president after another has insisted that U.S. foreign policy is more than crass self-interest, oil, money, or global supremacy, end quote. And for many analysts, myself included, this approach has been a critical component in sustaining U.S. power and influence in the world. But has the president-elect at least suggested an approach toward U.S. engagement in the world? If he has, it might at this point be best described as what the president-elect himself has called an America First approach, informed by a view toward diplomacy that is, I think fair to say, largely transactional. Though some might also say he may be most closely aligned with what might be termed, a kind of an uber Hobbesian approach that suggests the United States must be the big dog in the international community, but without a defining set of principles that, again, to quote Barnett, that gives purpose to power. And because such an approach, to my mind, doesn't make use of the tools of influence that have stood the test of time, I don't believe it's going to be a sustainable path. It's not, at least for U.S. engagement and sustained U.S. power. Thus, I believe a yet-to-be-determined approach, informed in large measure by the president-elect's choices for Secretary of State and Secretary of Defense, will evolve. But time will tell its contours and its implications for U.S. national security. And I did it within 5 minutes. I think that what we can do is go right to the questions, unless any of our panelists have any particular points that they want to raise that are of particular importance. Okay, I've got a whole bunch of questions. I've got some great questions, and I sound like the president-elect, don't I? And with apologies, because we have more questions than we're going to have time, but let's see how many of these we can get to. Over the past, this may be a question largely for Christina, but we'll start with Christina, and then we can go to others. Over the past decade, the United States has taken a significantly more progressive stance on LGBTQ rights, both domestically through repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell and Equal Marriage, and internationally via the State Department and pressure on countries with anti-homosexuality laws. Though the president-elect has been ambiguous on this point, he did name a vice president who believes in conversion therapy. I'm reading the questions as written. How do you all believe LGBTQ rights will be impacted by this administration, both domestically and internationally? Sort of restates some of the points that you made, but let me give you, Christina, the opportunity to offer a few additional comments.
Sure. I think this is a particularly muddy area. Hard to tell how this administration will proceed. I mean, the question writer is correct that this LGBTQ rights would be rolled back if Vice President-elect Pence were president. Trump, however, did make a point following the Miami massacre, nightclub massacre, of protecting LGBTQ rights, and has made some positive statements with regard to that. As I was looking into what was most recent in terms of his proposed child care policy, apparently Ivanka Trump gave a interview to Cosmopolitan magazine recently saying that the child care tax deductions would not apply to gay dads and same-sex couples. Who knows? I mean, we don't have a formal policy for this yet. But there's very mixed messages on this question. So it's a good question and something definitely to keep an eye on as it evolves.
Thank you. And by the way, at any point, if any of the other panelists want to chime in, just raise your hand and let me know. Art addressed this question, but I'm interested in the perspectives of Art, if you have more, and other panelists. Have your attitudes about the administration changed since the president-elect started making his appointments?
Can I start with that one?
By all means.
So I didn't touch in my remarks on the presumed appointee for Attorney General. That's Senator Jeff Sessions. He's had a long career in the Senate. He's been unambiguously anti-immigration, actually quite to the right of even his Republican counterparts. He breaks considerably from what I have taken to be Republican orthodox around supporting Chamber of Commerce positions. He breaks considerably from even thinking about STEM and many people's assessment that we have a shortage of highly qualified STEM workers in the United States. So if anything, it's redoubled my belief that Trump is moving very aggressively in an anti-immigration stance in his presidency, and through his appointment of Jeff Sessions, he's demonstrating that.
Art, could you address an issue that you didn't address in your opening remarks about the education appointee? And that is, and there's been a lot of discussion about her position on accountability for private schools and charter schools. And I'd be interested in your perspective.
As the dean knows, I'm from Detroit. I've got lots of relatives in Michigan. I have a cousin who was a state senator, and I, of course, started calling my relatives, my cousin in particular, on this very question. And it was quite disturbing to me because it was my understanding, Trump proposed appointment here, Nancy DeVos, that her main objective is, in Michigan in particular, and Detroit in particular, the public school system is failing the kids. And her objective is to get better outcomes for children. And I think most of us will agree that we want the best outcomes we can for children. Charter schools, I mean, we have some tremendous people in this state that started that movement. And while I think the research is out on whether charter schools are the silver bullet, in fact, I think it's very controversial, I think it's something that we should be looking at. And so I applauded her for that kind of approach. But then in Michigan, she fought very hard and was successful in limiting the accountability of the charter schools. And in the area that I've been working on early childhood education, if you don't have high quality programs for our most vulnerable kids, it isn't gonna work. If the programs are simply putting the kids in front of a TV in a child care program, that doesn't work. We need high quality, and our program in this state, our scholarships, can only be used at 4-star rated programs. So I am hoping that the information that we have gotten so far on her unwillingness to back accountability is something that is negotiable. And we have enough research to show that how critical it is that we have accountability across the board. And in fact, in some of the cases in Michigan, some of these charter schools that didn't have this accountability, there were some serious problems. So I think that is a concern.
Anu?
I might just add that the fact that Donald Trump's been talking to Mitt Romney and Nikki Haley, I just found that really interesting, that these were people who had been, Mitt Romney had been extremely critical, and that they had that capacity to talk and continue to engage, it was interesting to me.
Yeah, I mean, I will just say that the appointments have shown that while Trump ran as an anti-establishment, an outsider, when he's coming to appoint, he's actually appointing a lot of very intimate insiders, especially in the economic arena, but also in some of the foreign policy, if the appointment of Romney goes through. But I think the fact that one of his strategic advisors is so much of an outsider and a fringe hard right, that we will have to see what that implies.
Okay. This is a question which really is, I think, for any of the panelists. And it's really about the accountability of power. I'm just going to read the question, and you can infer from it what you want. But it arises to my mind in the context of some statements about flag burning, for example, and the consequences that should result from burning the flag. And so the questioner writes, what and how do we, the people, accurately keep a, quote, eye on the president-elect's use of power in this age of Fox News? Please advise.
Well, I mean, I'm going to just talk about the new emerging industry of false news, which goes well beyond Fox News, and the story about this young enterprising person in Tbilisi, Georgia, who set up this website to disseminate false news in the US and gets tremendous amount of revenue because he gets lots of clicks and Google ads, and then that false news can disseminate so quickly in this media environment with very little checks and balances as far as what people read and what people believe. I think that's a really new phenomenon and quite dangerous. And so I would say that that's part of the phenomenon that we have seen with the rise of populism.
Anyone else on this issue? Okay. There's a question for me here, so I'll answer it. And then maybe Raghi will have some perspectives as well. And it's on the Iran nuclear deal. Do you see it being scrapped by President Trump? My answer to that question is I'm not quite sure what he's going to do with that. Because right now, the Iranians, by and large, have complied with the terms of the agreement. And, you know, that's a good thing in terms of what they have agreed to forego and what they've agreed to ship out and all kinds of things that were consistent with American interests and American policy. And the agreement itself is a multilateral agreement. The United States is one of a number of countries that agreed with the government of Iran on this issue. So I'm not sure what, I mean, pulling out, it seems to me, would create the potential pretext or justification on the part of the Iranians to break out of an agreement which right now, on some, at least to some extent, no matter what your perspective, is meeting our foreign policy interests. So I don't really know, you know, what the conversation within the Trump administration, the transition team on the Iran nuclear agreement is looking like right now. I'm sorry I haven't answered your question, but I think that's the, at least what I think I've done, I hope, is pointed up the dilemma confronting a Trump administration. I mean, if we're in a situation where the Iranians had just completely ignored the terms of the agreement, had broken out and are kind of, then it's an easy issue. But right now, we've got an agreement which is largely serving American national security interests. And the only thing our breaking out of the agreement would do would be to provide a justification for the Iranians to do the same thing. So I'm not exactly sure what the answer to this question is, although I talked around it for a couple of minutes. Raghi, do you have any perspective?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's going to be rather hard to pull out from these international agreements because, as you said, they're multilateral as opposed to bilateral. But my concern is, as I mentioned earlier, about the balance of powers between hardliners and reformers within Iran, and what that does that mean for if the hardliners are strengthened by this kind of greater polarization of the relationship with the U.S., what does that mean for Iran's actions other than the nuclear agreement, and in particular, Iran's action in places like Yemen in supporting some of the Shiite hardliners in the Gulf and also in Syria. So I think that the movement towards more reformist-minded politicians in Iran was probably one of the best developments in the Iranian in the relationship with Iran, and that could be reversed as a result of the relationship with the U.S. Now, whether that means the hardliners will push for breaking the agreement, getting out of the agreement, that's really open to question. So there are two players here. On the Iranian side, there is a risk of them wanting to break out if the hardliners win. And on the Trump side, there's also a potential for him to pull out.
Thank you. I've got two questions which I think I'm going to direct to Anu. And you've addressed some of these in your remarks, but I'm going to ask them anyway. As written, the question is, could Mr. Trump, and you got to do more than a yes or no to answer this question. I'd be interested in your broader perspective. Could Mr. Trump enhance cooperation with other governments in the context of addressing climate issues? And the second question really has to do with the immigration, I think, the immigration approach that President-elect Trump has articulated in terms of its impact on researchers and academics who may be coming here and who may benefit our academic institutions and society generally.
So maybe I can speak to the first question first, and that is, I think this campaign was run on, I can make deals. And so to the extent that some of these trade deals may be having an environmental component, or that the environmental components could be part of some of these trade deals, there may be potential, because I think that was the question, could there be something positive coming out of this? And so that could be a way of thinking about it. When we have these international trade agreements, what is, how are we thinking about the environment? And sort of a corollary, if I can just add something technical, I can't resist it. But, we've talked about trade and trade in general, and what has happened is that so much of our manufacturing has gone to other countries that may not necessarily have good, efficient, energy-efficient production. What's happened globally is actually we've become less productive, or, in terms of GDP, we're using more energy, we're using more resources than we did. And there may be some positive approaches where you can start to connect trade with global environmental thinking, which we haven't seen, but there's potential to do that, which would be interesting. On the second question, I don't know enough about, I don't think we know, maybe Ryan does, about the details of the immigration policy with respect to researchers from other countries. But I think in general, this notion of American leadership in research, especially the world, like Eric said, is very much going to be led by Asia, just because of population of China and India and Asia in general, and big urbanization coming up in Africa. And if the US wants to be a leader and a business leader and create business opportunities, I don't think we can disengage from clean energy topics. I think we're going to have to be pushed there just by economic interests, because the world is not going towards dirty energy. They're going to go towards clean energy for various reasons. And so I still see there may be opportunities if these visions could be coming forward.
I've got a question for Professor Assad. None of the policy matters that the president-elect has discussed has any constituency except for a desire for deal making. In line with, I'm just going to read it as written. In line with Erdogan and Sisi's endorsement, the likelihood of deal making with dictators is higher. Is it a threat to accountable democracy? Again, no yes or no. We need more than that.
Well, I mean, I do think that de-emphasizing the U.S. role in highlighting the promotion of democracy and the promotion of human rights around the world is going to basically embolden leaders in parts of the world that are deconsolidating democracy and will give them greater justification. I mean, I think that the fact that Trump has focused on the Putin as a strong man and rather than Putin as the authoritarian leader will be seen as an example of how Trump is likely to deal with rising authoritarianism. And I have to say that this issue of kind of the rise of populism and particularly right-wing populism and the decline of democracy is not a U.S.-only phenomenon. That's happening across the world, and it's happening in the developing world as much as it's happening in the developed world. And so, and I don't know if you've seen the article this morning in the New York Times about how younger generations in particular around the world put a lot less value on democracy, are much less, much more willing to say that democracy is not so important to me in the country that I'm living in. And I think it's not just in the U.S., but elsewhere. So I do think that democracy is increasingly under siege in many parts of the world, and there are forces to deconsolidate democracy in many places where it has taken root.
I want to comment on that, and as a transition to a more general question, the any new administration that comes into office and is reluctant or disdainful of principles surrounding democracy and human rights and foreign policy is going to run up against an infrastructure of legislation and legislative provisions and prohibitions that will make it difficult to simply reject decades of policies designed to promote human rights and democracy, legislation affecting foreign assistance to governments that violate human rights, legislation that requires some examination of foreign military units that are receiving U.S. military assistance. And so I think it's important to note that although foreign policy is perhaps the area where presidential prerogative is at its greatest, even in that area, there are legislative provisions that have really kind of impacted and in some measure defined U.S. foreign policy priorities over the past couple of few decades. And so that leads me to a general question for the rest of the panel, which is, the U.S. is a big ship. To what extent is the power of the new administration limited by the inertia of current systems For example, states fund 90% of education. Electric transmission organizations see current market trends leading to reductions equal to the proposed effects of the clean power plan, et cetera, et cetera. So that's a broad question for all of the panelists. Any reactions? You don't have to answer the question.
Well, I'm happy to answer any question. faculty members love to talk. In respect to the comments that you just made, Eric, and the question itself, I think it's interesting thinking about immigration policy in the United States. We've been phenomenally unsuccessful in Congress in passing any kind of comprehensive immigration reform, despite, I think, widespread agreement that it's needed. And we're essentially operating under a policy that no one likes, that people see a lot of room to change, but because of gridlock in Congress haven't done so. And so what President Trump will have the authority to do is rescind many of the executive orders that have been some of the most kind of prominent areas of immigration policy in the last several years, or certainly within this administration. And so in some respects, there is some leeway. The executive of the United States, the president, has broad authority to change many aspects of immigration policy. It's certainly not unlimited authority. But in contrast to issues related to education, where the states do play a much more fundamental role, immigration seems to me to be one that's much more amenable to change at the executive level.
I'll just weigh in a general way on the question. While there are ways in which the president, as Ryan has said, can exercise direct authority in much the same way that Obama has been doing with a gridlocked Congress, and has taken executive authority to a new level, President Trump will be with a entirely Republican Congress. So I think we can expect to see some change when the president-elect's policies align with the Republican Party. And we are certainly seeing him, as with his discussions with Romney, as with many of his appointees, that many of which represent not midstream Republican, but more of the more right-leaning end of the Republican spectrum. We will see change. And this ship, yes, it moves slowly in the United States, but we will see swifter change due to a lack of gridlock.
Just a quick comment on the economy. I generally have argued that this is a very resilient economy. It has been for many years, and despite certain hits and despite a business cycle and recessions, if you look at the long-term trend, this is the greatest economy in the world. There's nothing close to it. However, if you go back to the 1930s, where you heard an awful lot of nativism back then, America first, we got to protect our jobs. And Congress passed something called the Smoot-Hawley Act, which basically started a trade war that ended international trade. The statistics are pretty obvious and frightening if you look back at that time. And I would argue, and many scholars have argued, that probably the major cause of the Great Depression was this ending of world trade. And today, about a third of our economy is dependent on world trade. And if this attempt to make better deals leads to another trade war, I would be very concerned about what this will imply. And world trade doesn't just benefit us, it benefits other economies. And if you're looking long-term and you want to talk about political health and well-being and safety in our world, we want all these economies to succeed. The more they succeed, the more likely we'll get political stability in these economies. I would argue China has clearly moved in that direction as they have adopted the Hong Kong model. I think, again, like I argued with banks, you want more of these countries to have skin in the game, to have successful economies. You're more likely to get sustainable democracies. You're more likely to perpetuate peace if there are more beneficiaries to the world economic growth, and that's going to depend on trade. So it bothers me, and it has bothered me in this debate on the presidential debates, that trade has generally been viewed in a negative way as us losing jobs. In fact, on net, trade that we've done, whether it's a North American Free Trade Agreement, or general trade agreements on that they do create jobs. They're winners and losers, and we have to worry about that. But understand that economies become great, and this is history of economics, become trade great when they're open to trade. And we have been a leader on that. So if we start backing off on that, that would be a concern.
Art, I want to come back to you on another question, which is, we've gotten a couple of questions along this along these lines, which is, number one, how feasible is a large-scale infrastructure program, given the reluctance of the Republican Congress to fund that kind of program, number one? And number two, how do you square it in fiscal terms, given the tax proposals that the president-elect has articulated? How's that all going to play out?
First of all, I think it's hard to reconcile the two, and I think the Republican Party in particular is going to have a tough one on this. On the economics, it's clear we've got problems with infrastructure. Even in our state, we know this. We've done a number of studies on transportation needs going out, and we need billions of dollars just to maintain the current level of our infrastructure, and we're struggling in this state to figure out a way to fund that. So nationally, the Republican Party is going to have a hard time with the notion that we have a president, our president-elect, who wants to spend the significant, I think it was $1 trillion, on new infrastructure, and a Republican Party that's been very, very conservative on federal spending. I think with the right economic advisors, and I don't really know who they're going to be, I think the economic case for our infrastructure is very strong. I would add to infrastructure, well, you better invest in human capital. I try to use that as part of the infrastructure argument. It is very clear if education was important over the last 50 years, it's going to be that much more important over the next 50 years. There's a lack of skilled workers now. It's only going to be worse if we fail to educate our workers. So this infrastructure argument, I would broaden it, and I would look, as I've tried to make the case, let's look at the benefit cost, let's look at the return on this public investment, and it is huge when you look at our infrastructure. We had a bridge collapse, for example, and it is huge when you look at the importance of educating our kids, all our kids. We can't afford the achievement gap in Minnesota. We can't afford it nationally. And unfortunately, it's growing because more and more of our kids are born into poverty. That's an infrastructure issue that we have to face long term. I don't know how the Republican Party is going to deal with it. I am hoping, given American Enterprise Institute in particular, that have glommed onto this issue, that we will make some progress in this area. But like the rest of the panelists said, there's a lot of uncertainty going forward.
We've got about 5 minutes left. So what I'm going to do is ask one question to Ryan Allen and ask him to give a short answer, while I invite the panelists to reflect on what they'd like to use 30 seconds to offer final comments. And you've been so respectful of the time limitations that I have every confidence that we'll be out of here by 1:15. So as our panelists reflect on what they might want to impart, for Ryan, the president-elect says less immigration, more jobs. But isn't it true that sectors of our economy will collapse without at least 5 to 6 million undocumented workers, sectors like agriculture and restaurants?
So in short, collapse is a dramatic word, but will certainly take a hit. If you see the kind of concentration of particularly unauthorized workers in particular industries, it's clear that in agriculture and construction and restaurants and other kind of service, it will be very, very difficult for some of those industries to maintain their current level of profitability and so on without these workers. How was that? Pretty short?
That was pretty short.
Okay, I'm going to start from the far end and invite each one of our panelists really to just offer a few closing comments, and then you'll join me in thanking them all. Raghi.
Yeah, I mean, I think the dramatic difference between what the Obama administration has done in terms of the relationship with the Islamic world versus the previous administration was to change the tone and to change the rhetoric and the message that is being transmitted. And one of the first things that President Obama did is to go to Cairo and give his speech about
trying to change that relationship. So I think if we have a reversal in that and go back to the strident tone that we had during the Bush administration in the post 9/11 period, I think that's really one of the major dangers that we're going to face in terms of being able to defeat the scourge of terrorism and extremism in the region, because we don't want them to be able to align themselves and basically to dictate the actions of the U.S. through one terrorist attack, basically prompting the U.S. to do things that are against the U.S. interest.
Thank you. Anu?
I just wanted to maybe connect a few questions that we've had previously as to what can we do. Please advise, you know, that question, and this comment about democracy, that younger people are seeing less and less value. And I just wanted to say, this is still a very divided country. You know, if you look at how slim the margins were, state by state, a few states, a few votes turned this in such a dramatic way, we're still divided. And I just wanted to make the comment that it's really important that each of us don't take things for granted. We've taken women's rights, reproductive rights, clean air, clean water. You open your tap, your infrastructure runs. These things have been a product of so much good policy that we take them for granted, and that reminding young people to not take these things for granted would be my biggest takeaway.
Christina?
Well, I think I'd like to close circling back to the topic of gender and gender equality and equity, and pointing out that while I raised some of the areas where we first think about gender equality and gender equity, there are many other areas we need to keep our eye on, whether it's proposals to increase the role of private contractors in our prison system, where women are the largest increasing group of incarcerated individuals, or whether it's looking at areas like foreign policy and whether or not the United States will continue to abide by Security Council Resolution 1325 that allows for the full participation of women in peacekeeping and conflict resolution processes. So there's a range of areas where there can be changes that may be less noticed, but nonetheless will affect at home and abroad the equity between men, women, and people of other genders.
I'd just like to comment on the economics of immigration. Trade in general, as I've argued, is important for sustainable economic growth. This country is an example of how important our immigrants have been over the years to sustain the growth in this economy. Economics and open economies, we're not just open to goods and services, but ideas and people, and that's what made this economy so great. And so to back off on that would be, from an economic point of view, I can easily make the moral argument as to why that's a wrong policy to back away from immigration. But to keep this country as open to immigrants and people who want to work in this country, that is would be, from an economic point of view, a serious mistake.
So many of my planning students are in the audience at my behest, and so I would be remiss if I didn't talk about housing. The proposed nominee for Secretary of HUD is Ben Carson. He has not accepted that nomination yet and certainly hasn't been through the process. But it's unclear to me, while he may have many skills, that any of those involve any kind of expertise related to urban poverty, to housing issues, and more generally to a planning issues that are important to me. And so for me, that's really quite discouraging. It signals a disregard for these issues, which I think are of paramount importance in the United States right now, in the Trump administration.
I guess my only closing remarks will be that whatever your political perspectives, nobody will dispute the notion that this was an election with profound consequences for the future of our country. And it's an election that has stirred the passions of our community, certainly within the Humphrey School. I think the challenges over the next 4, 8, 10, 20 years really, to my mind, validate the notion that we are engaged here in teaching about governance from the broadest perspective, leadership, advocacy, engagement in community organizing, as well as training for people who want to work in government. As I say, this election has stirred the passions of many different communities. The one thing I am certain of is we only benefit by fora like this one, where we have the opportunity to explore policy issues and policy implications, and we will continue to try to play that role in the weeks, months, and years to come. So please join me in thanking our panelists, and thank you all for being here.